हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल?
यू ट्राई मूविंग योर स्क्रीन अक्षर? Yeah, okay.
गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड
सी ऑल
मॉर्निंग।
कैन गुड मॉर्निंग सी ऑल कैन स्टार्ट इन अ मिनट। ओके।
यस।
Can start now.
Good morning, everyone. The topic for today's war round is radiation proctitis. So here we have a female, 56-year-old postmenopausal lady, homemaker, resident of Mumbai. She was apparently all right 20 days back. Then she noticed painless passage of scant amount of blood with stool. This was occasional to begin with initially, but she had up to 2 to 3 episodes of bleeding per rectum per day for the last 1 week. She also had rectal discomfort, which was progressively increasing over the last 20 days. She had no history of fever, abdominal pain, constipation, or any altered bowel habits. There was no burning micturition. There was no history of hematuria or bleeding per vagina. And there was no history of anticoagulant intake. She is a diagnosed case of squamous cell carcinoma cervix, stage 2B, in January 2020. And during that time, she had received external beam radiotherapy to pelvis to a dose of 46 gray in 23 fraction using box field technique, along with concurrent 2 cycles of weekly cisplatin. The remaining cisplatin was deferred in view of COVID pandemic. After that, she had received four cycles of intracavitary application, and her treatment got completed on 8th of May 2020. The total EQD2 to point A was 76.7 gray, bladder 2cc EQD2 was 95.14 gray, and rectum 2cc EQD2 was 66.3 gray. She is a known hypertensive for the last 16 years, and currently she is on tablet amlodipine 5 milligrams. There is no history of any prior surgeries. There is no history of tuberculosis or bronchial asthma. And she has no history of allergies or any drug reactions in the past. She's married, married 35 years back. She's a homemaker, completed education till primary school. That is, she has no history of any addictions, take mixed diet, and has maintained appetite. She has an adequate sleep for 6 to 7 hours per day. Her bowel and bladder movements are normal, and there is no history of malignancies in the family. Coming to the menstrual and the obstetric history, she attained menarche at the age of 13 years. She had regular menses with average flow over 3 to 4 days, which occurred monthly. And she used to use 3 to 4 pads per day during the menses. Her obstetric score is P4L4, and all were full-term normal vaginal delivery. And the last childbirth was 26. The age of 46 years. For and municipal wards, completed education in primary school. Amcom is 32, and she belongs to lower class as per the modified Kupusami scale. Coming to the general examination, patient was explained about the procedure, examined with due consent in a well-illuminated room in the presence of a female attendant. On examination, she was conscious, cooperative, and well-oriented to time, place, and person. Her KPS score was 80 and ECOG was 1. She was afebrile with a pulse rate of 90 per minute, which was regular, respiratory rate of 22 per minute, and a blood pressure of 120 over 80 millimeters of mercury. On examination, there was pallor. There was no icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy, or edema. Her skin, hair, and nail conditions were normal. Coming to the systemic examination, she had normal systemic examination. See, on CNS examination, her eye mental functions were intact and there were no neurological deficits. She had bilateral equal air entry with no added sound. Cardiac sounds were normal with no murmurs. Bilateral breast examination was normal. On per abdomen examination, abdomen was soft and non-tender and there were no organomegaly. And she had no bony tenderness. On local examination, on per speculum examination, no abnormality was detected. On per vaginal examination, cervix was flush with vagina. There was no residual disease. Bilateral parametrium were free. Vagina and rectal mucosa were smooth, but the rectal finger was smeared with blood. So we have a postmenopausal lady in her late 50s, known hypertensive on amlodipine 5 mg. Also a diagnosed case of CA cervix 2B. 1 year and 4 months post definitive CTRT, presented with complaint of painless bleeding per rectum for 20 days associated with mild rectal discomfort. The probable differential diagnosis, the first differential diagnosis would be RT-induced chronic proctitis, taking into account her history of previous RT to cervix. The other differential diagnosis, possible differential diagnosis are disease recurrence and progression, or inflammatory bowel disease, or a possibility of a second primary. Coming to the investigations done, routine lab investigations were done. Her hemoglobin was 7.7 and other parameters were normal. She had a normal coag profile. And on stool routine examination, there were RBCs present in abundance and rest of this workup were normal. She was managed symptomatically with tranexamic acid 1 gram IV stat followed by 500 mg TDS. She received 1 pint Paxil volume transfusion. She was started on oral hematinics, stool softeners, and enteform enema. Once the patient was stabilized, a sigmoidoscopy was done, which showed multiple telangiectasias from the anal verge till 15 cm. Rest of the visualized mucosa was normal till 40 cm, and the sigmoidoscopy impression was RT proctitis. Argon plasma coagulation was done to 50 to 60% of the telangiectasias from 5 to 15 cm. So summarizing the case, we have a postmenopausal lady in her 50s. She is a known hypertensive on amlodipine 5 mg. She's a treated case of CA cervix stage 2B, 1 year and 4 months post definitive CTRT. She presented with complaints of passage of blood in stool for 20 days, was managed symptomatically, and sigmoidoscopy showed multiple telangiectasias for which argon plasma coagulation was done. The overall impression is chronic RT-induced proctitis. So shall we move on to the discussion part?
Yeah, I think move on to the discussion part. We will then interrupt in between.
So over to Dr. Namrata for the discussion.
Good morning, everyone. We will discuss radiation-induced proctitis today. It is radiation-induced inflammation of the rectal mucosa, a complication which is encountered following radiation therapy for pelvic malignancies such as cancers of prostate, cervix, uterus, bladder, testicles, rectum, and lymphomas. It can be divided into two types, acute radiation proctitis and chronic radiation proctitis. Acute radiation proctitis usually occurs during or within first 3 months of radiation therapy. It is usually self-limited. Initially, it manifests with symptoms like mild diarrhea, urgency, tenesmus, cramping pain, and mild rectal bleeding. The endoscopic findings associated with acute radiation proctitis include mucosal ulceration, edema, erythema, and bleeding. Biopsy of these areas may reveal presence of eosinophilic crypt abscess, endothelial arteriolar swelling, loss of mucosal cells, and extensive inflammation. Chronic radiation proctitis usually occurs in 5 to 10% of the patients either as a progression from the acute phase or after 3 months of radiotherapy completion. The risk factors associated with chronic radiation proctitis include diabetes mellitus, then inflammatory bowel disease, any associated hypertension, smoking, peripheral vascular disease, and concurrent chemotherapy administration. Patient usually presents with complaints of rectal bleeding, but can also have symptoms of intestinal obstruction if there is presence of any strictures or fistulas between the rectum and adjacent organs. Endoscopic findings in chronic radiation proctitis include mucosal friability, pallor, telangiectasias. Patient may have stricture, fistulas, and ulcerations. Pathogenesis. The lining of the rectum is it has three layers. It has mucosa, which is lined by a single layer of simple columnar epithelium with interspersed goblet cells, which secrete mucus. And the epithelium dips into the submucosa to form intestinal crypt. There is submucosa, which contains connective tissue and blood vessels. And the third layer is muscularis layer, which contains inner smooth muscles and outer longitudinal muscles. The cells of the epithelium, they have microvilli. Acute radiation proctitis, the pathogenesis includes the radiation causes direct mucosal damage to the rectal mucosa, which results in loss or distortion of microvillus architecture with hyperemia, edema, and ulceration, which further results in loose watery stools with mucus due to goblet cells irritation. Chronic radiation proctitis, it is due to focal distortion and chronic focal distortion and destruction of small arteries and arterioles with intimal fibrosis, which results in compromise of blood vessels to the rectal wall due to obliterative end arthritis, which results in ischemia. The hypoxia, it also causes hypoxia, which results in formation neovascularization and telangiectasia formation. Hypoxia also causes oxidative stress, which further damages to the vessels. Evaluation. First, we have to take the history. In case of acute radiation proctitis, the symptoms usually occur during RT or within 90 days of RT. Patient usually presents with diarrhea, with mucus discharge, tenesmus, and bleeding is rare in acute radiation proctitis. The differential diagnosis may include acute gastroenteritis. We have to ask history regarding whether the patient has fever, abdominal pain, and we have to send labs such as stool routine, microscopy, culture sensitivity to rule out any infection. Then inflammatory bowel disease is also differential diagnosis. Then chronic radiation proctitis, patient mostly present mainly presents with bleeding, rectal pain, and there may be associated symptoms of obstruction due to stricture formation. We have to send the routine lab, stool routine microscopy. Then endoscopy is usually done to rule out the confirm the diagnosis and also to know the extent of radiation proctitis. Biopsy is not recommended as it is associated with increased risk of fistula formation. This slide here shows the endoscopic findings in case of chronic radiation proctitis. The findings in chronic radiation, endoscopic findings in chronic radiation proctitis are usually divided into three types. It can be inflammation predominant. It can be second type is bleeding predominant radiation, chronic radiation proctitis, or there may be a mixture of this both. In here, the image A shows the edema, mucosal edema along with the multiple telangiectic spots. In image B here shows the shows there is bleeding from the rectal wall. Image C shows there is necrosis, and image D here shows the ulceration in the rectal mucosa. Vienna rectoscopy score. It is used for the endoscopic classification of chronic chronic radiation proctitis. In this, the inner rectal mucosa, it is divided into 12 mucosal areas. Each area is scored on the presence and grading of telangiectasia, congested mucosa, ulceration, stricture, and necrosis.
What is this sound coming? Please, someone control.
This is RTOG grading for the acute and chronic radiation proctitis. In acute radiation proctitis, it has a grade four grades. Grade one include increased frequency of stools, change in bowel habits, or rectal discomfort not requiring medications or analgesics. Grade two include diarrhea requiring parasympatholytic drugs, mucus discharge which is not necessitating sanitary pads, abdominal or rectal pain requiring analgesics. Grade three is diarrhea requiring parenteral support, severe bloody or mucus discharge which necessitates sanitary pad usage, abdominal distension. Grade 4 includes acute or subacute obstruction, fistula or perforation, or any GI bleeding requiring transfusion, abdominal pain, or tenesmus requiring tube compression or diversion. chronic, similarly, chronic radiation proctitis, it is divided into four grades. Grade one includes mild diarrhea, mild cramping, bowel movements 5 times daily, slight rectal discharge or bleeding. Grade two involves moderate diarrhea or colic, bowel movements more than 5 times daily, excessive rectal mucus or intermittent bleeding. Grade three involves obstruction or bleeding which requires surgery. And grade four is necrosis, perforation or fistula. Moving to the management of radiation proctitis, this slide here shows the
just hold on before we now go to the management, let us discuss, have some discussion points. So one thing is the risk factor. Okay, we'll come about management later. So what are the, if you broadly classify, you had all the things on your slide, but when you are asked how you bring it out. So what are the risk factors for radiation proctitis? If you divide it into the host related and treatment and disease related.
Sir, okay?
And you're talking of all oncological scenarios. Okay, you're not just limiting to cancer of the cervix, but.
Okay. Sir, patient related factors, any comorbidities such as
diabetes. Okay, so diabetes and?
Peripheral vascular disease, any inflammatory bowel disease, if patient has, then any associated.
So one second. So why diabetes and the second more most common comorbidities other than diabetes?
Hypertension.
Hypertension. So why these two things? We had discussed this last week, but again, I want to re-emphasize this. So why diabetes and hypertension? Why they are a risk factor for radiation proctitis and cystitis?
Sir, prolonged diabetes and hypertension causes vasculopathy.
Okay. Yeah, always. I mean, these are chronic diseases. So, they are already vascular changes. So, when you say vascular, okay. So, and what is the pathophysiology of late radiation proctitis? If you can just say in a nutshell, just if you have to give, just write a very short para on pathophysiology of radiation proctitis. What is the key thing which happens, which gives rise to all the other symptoms and signs?
Sir, there is obliterative endarthritis, which results in ischemia, which further causes ischemic, which further causes the oxidative stress, which further damages the vessel. Vessels, and secondly, the hypoxia gives rise to neovascularization, telangiectasia formation. These blood vessels are usually fragile, they lead to bleeding.
Yes, okay, I think you have said it right. And with a period of time, the mucosal integrity also gets affected, okay, because when the blood supply is less, the mucosa, you may have ulceration on all those things, okay. Fair enough. I think that was this thing. So this is the pathophysiology. So what all things could, so when you said is the chronic diseases like hypertension and diabetes, especially uncontrolled, there's already an element of vasculopathy, and you just need a little bit more from radiation, and then you have the proctitis. So it's precipitated earlier. What else? Patient related. So inflammatory bowel disease. So anything which is causing, you know, inflammatory condition of the bowel. That is true. Then what else?
Sir, if the patient is a chronic smoker and is having...
Yes, chronic smoking also, yeah, effect causes vasculopathy. Yes.
Then, sir, patient-related factors.
So, patient's anatomy.
Yes, sir.
What patients can do to themselves to change the way they look? Can the height change? No. You know? But what can change? The weight.
Yes.
Okay. So if you look at the literature, so in obese, of course, obesity also goes hand in hand with chronic disease, but it becomes more challenging. And if you look at the literature, earlier literature from India, from PGI and other places, they have just correlated the patient's anterior-posterior separation. Because machines, you know, high energy Linacs were not available always. And, you know, even if they were there, you could not use it with all techniques. So with the AP separation is more. And if you use parallel opposed, the dose, you know that, I don't have to tell you all now, that there may be high dose regions over the rectum and the bladder. Okay, so patient's anatomy, so very obese patients. Okay, so that is one. And what else?
Age, young patients.
Age, okay, so with age as such, so age always you should say first. Okay, so old, elderly patients with chronic conditions like diabetes and hypertension, inflammatory bowel disease, obese patients, and chronic smokers. Okay.
Yes.
What else? So this is a patient-related factor. Then disease-related, is it common in some illnesses, some cancers? So it is pelvic cancers, pelvic malignancies requiring high-dose radiation. In the pelvic malignancies, which ones have the highest incidence?
So the rectal cancers, prostate cancers, cervical cancers, they're...
So rectal cancer, definitive radiotherapy is generally not done. Okay, it is generally adjuvant, either preoperative or something else. So definitive radiotherapy is done for which malignancies of the pelvis?
Cervical cancer, prostate.
Yes, cervix and prostate. These are the two lesions. Okay. So what is the difference of radiation proctitis between, say, prostate cancer and cervical cancer? So these are the two common malignancies where radiation proctitis happens, pelvic malignancy. So if you are in a prostate cancer clinic or uro-oncology clinic versus even a gyne-oncology clinic, so the pattern of radiation proctitis that you might see, would it be any broad differences? So let us say the pattern of proctitis or where it is located.
Sir, anterior wall.
Anterior wall. In
prostate
and in cervix, is it the posterior wall?
No, sir, anterior.
So why anterior wall in cervix and why anterior wall in prostate? See, when you say something now, when you are specifying anterior wall, then while you are doing your MD, you are also expected to know why it is so. I mean, if it is not written, you also should ask the question. Just read it up. Think. Most of the time, just by thinking, you will get the answer. Sir, if by thinking, you don't get the answer, then read. Bolo.
Sir, it is in more proximity to the treating area, the anterior wall.
What do you mean by treating area? You are a radiation oncologist trainee. You can't just say treating area. What is it called?
PTV.
Okay, PTV. Planning target volume. Okay. So, okay. So that is one thing. And in cervix, why does the anterior rectal wall gets the high dose?
So, in cervical cancer, the patient are also given brachytherapy. So,
not also are given. Intracavitary or interstitial brachytherapy is an integral part of cervical cancer radiotherapy. Okay. It's not also given. That is one of the very important things. Okay. And so, what does it? So then say, go ahead. So after brachytherapy, what? So you're right. So because you say in cervical cancer, acute anterior rectal wall, because brachytherapy is an integral part of the treatment, then what?
So the anterior wall of the rectum is closer to the brachytherapy source.
Yes,
so
it is. Yes. Okay. So I'm sure Namrata also knew it. She was unable to put it in words. So because of the rapid fall off of dose with inverse square law, the region of the rectum which is closest to the sources, which is the anterior rectal wall, gets the maximum dose of radiation and will obviously show this thing. Okay, so that's fine. Okay, then what else? And then disease related, let us say in disease related, which rectal cancer, I'm excluding rectal cancer, which prostate cancer patients, I'm talking of just the disease, forget about the host-related factors, are more likely to get radiation proctitis because of the type of disease they have, the extent of disease, and same for cervical cancer.
Cervical cancer. prostate cancers involving the posterior part of the prostate.
Posterior part of the prostate. Okay. So when you want to do a higher dose or a SIB, whichever way to, and it is more posteriorly placed. So always, you know, it is very small, very localized, or involving, you know, seminal vesicles or also lymph nodes. You know, sometimes you also have to treat the pelvis. It's not that you never have to treat the pelvis. It is not prostate only field. So the moment your fields increase, it's a volume effect. Okay, then it is possible to use sometimes spare completely the organ, sometimes only partially. So that is in cervical cancer, which patients are more likely because of the nature or the extent of disease, more likely to get radiation proctitis.
Disease involving the posterior lip of the cervix.
Posterior lip of the cervix, I mean, there will be very few patients where it is entirely confined to the anterior lip of the cervix, okay? So, only some stage 1 cancer that will be confined to anterior lip. So, go a little more beyond that. So, posterior lip, we assume that, and whether posterior lip is involved or not, your brachytherapy will not change, no? Or will it change? If posterior lip of the cervix was not involved, would you do a different kind of brachytherapy for those patients?
No.
Just tell me. She will not do, no? So, whether posterior lip is involved or not, your brachytherapy, when you just do a PVPR, when you just see or feel the cervix, it might look different or feel different. Could that? So, yes, remember we had 2 or 3 sessions on CS cervix. You know, even Dr. Shivastav had come and he shared his pearls of wisdom. So,
parametrial involvement.
Before parametrium, just go to the cervix. Can shape of the cervix be different? There are some names given to that shape of cervix, if you can recall. Barrel-shaped cervix. Okay, so when the growth in the cervix is too large, okay, it's a very, very large cervical growth, may or may not be barrel shaped. So why does that increase the risk of radiation proctitis?
So the PTV would be a large total planning.
So I mean, so when in those patients you require more of, see, cervical cancer treatment is always a combination between external beam and intracavitary. These days with protocol, we have fixed, okay, external beam dose is 46 and this much is this. But many times in real life, you have to balance. If suppose sufficient regression of the primary tumor has not happened, you tend to give more dose with external beam. And because you have want to do a good intracavitary application. So if you are not strictly adhering to a protocol of external beam dose and intracavitary, you may give a higher dose with external beam compared to the intracavitary. That is one thing. Most institutions have fixed the regimen, but many institutions have not fixed, and they would use, I mean, 2 to 4 gray more. Instead of 46 gray, they might give 50 gray with external beam in those who have a large bulky. Plus, your intracavitary, if there is a very bulky growth, you may not be able to do a good intracavitary placement in terms of the geometry of the applicators when they're in situ. Plus, packing becomes more difficult. Okay, so you give a higher dose to the rectum. So the anatomy, when they say the anatomy of the disease and the pelvis, and similarly in anatomy, in elderly patients, if they have a atrophic vagina which is not very pliable, not stretchable, you may not be able to put in a bigger cylinder. Yeah, bigger ovoid, you know, larger diameter ovoid, and you can't do good posterior packing. Okay, so these are the patient-related factors. Okay, now treatment-related, the key thing in treatment-related factors for the radiation proctitis risk.
So the technique of radiation.
Everything, it just, you say one thing, it will be covering everything. So it is the. What? It is the dose and volume. Okay. And when we say dose in radiation practice, we talk about biologically equivalent dose. And for biological equivalent dose, what you need to know, what is the information that you have to have with you to talk about biologically equivalent dose? You have to know the fraction sensitivity. Okay. What else, in addition to fraction sensitivity, what else you need to know? If it was a tumor, in addition to fraction sensitivity, what else you need to know? Whether there is any time effect.
Yes.
Okay. So previously, you know, it's not that for late effects or consequential reactions, there is no time effect. There is time effect, but not as pronounced. So in most of the time, we ignore that. So that you should keep in mind. Okay. So the biologically equivalent dose, the volume, and you know, the technique basically just that does that. Okay, so the technique is just reducing the dose to that organ. Okay, yes. Okay, carry on.
Moving to the management of radiation proctitis. This flowchart here shows the gives the brief idea about how to manage radiation proctitis. First, we have to assess the patient with on the basis of signs and symptoms of proctitis, whether it is acute or chronic proctitis. In case of acute radiation proctitis, it is usually self-limiting, and supportive care in the form of maintaining hydration, antidiarrheal agents, analgesics, steroid enema are sufficient, and cessation of radiotherapy is required in grade 3 and grade 4 acute radiation proctitis. In case of chronic radiation proctitis, first we have to determine what is the severity of proctitis. If it is grade 1 or grade 2 radiation proctitis, we can start with the medical therapy in the form of anti-inflammatory drugs, antioxidants. If the patient has on this treatment, patient has persistent signs and symptoms of proctitis, we can add sucralfate, enema, short chain fatty acids, or and consider patient for hyperbaric oxygen therapy. In case of grade 3 radiation proctitis, in case of persistent signs and symptoms, we can offer ablation therapies such as with the help in the form of formalin or YAG laser or argon plasma coagulation. In case of grade 4 chronic proctitis, surgical intervention is required. This is a treatment algorithm which is given by Veniste et al.
One second. Before you go ahead, I want to ask, maybe Akshay, you should answer this. So when you evaluate a patient, one patient is on your radiotherapy for, say, prostate cancer, localized fields, or maybe cervical cancer. So symptoms suggestive of acute proctitis. What are the few questions you would ask? And is there any clinical evaluation would you do? And then we'll come to the management. First, you have to establish your diagnosis. Okay. You don't have a proctologist. Okay. Proctologists are doctors who specialize in the disease of the rectum and anal canals. You don't have them. You have to make the diagnosis. So first you have to be sure of your diagnosis, that is acute radiation proctitis, and then only you can manage it. So Dinesh.
Yes, sir.
Akshay, sorry.
When a patient with suspected radiation proctitis come to us, we'll start from...
I'm talking of patients who are receiving conventional fractionation. You know, SBRT is different. I mean, many of us don't have the feel how to, you know, when they manifest and how they manifest. You know, it may happen 2 weeks later. So patient is having conventional fractionation, 2 or 2.5 gray per day, and it is the fourth week.
Yes, sir. So first thing, we'll have to ask the history regarding what all kinds of, what all symptoms he is having, whether it is bleeding, tenesmus, mucus or mucus discharge, what are the kinds of symptoms? And
patient is telling ki patient's daughter tells you daddy is having diarrhea for last 3 days.
Yes, sir. So since the patient is in the fourth week of radiotherapy.
No, listen. So I'm telling you, patient's daughter is telling you, doctor, daddy is having diarrhea for last 3 days. Then.
We'll characterize the frequency of the diarrhea, amount of diarrhea.
He tells you, and then the daddy comes in and he says, yes, 4 or 5 times yesterday, I had to go to the loo, chandas, as they say.
Then we'll ask for associated symptoms, like whether the diarrhea was, like it was foul smelling, or it was watery in nature, whether he's having an associated fever, abdominal cramps.
No fever, it was not watery, and no foul smell.
So in that case, it doesn't look like an infective cause of diarrhea. So yeah.
You have ruled out infective diarrhea. I'm very happy then.
So regarding in the history, we'll also ask like other symptoms, like what are the other symptoms apart from diarrhea, whether he's having any other symptoms, local symptoms like bleeding or.
So he says no bleeding. So you ask the question, I will answer. The daddy is here, bolo. See, you have to first come to a almost definitive diagnosis that yes, this is acute radiation proctitis.
Yes.
So the history of diarrhea. I mean, that diarrhea is a commoner's word also. It is not always a medical terminology. A medical terminology, when we say diarrhea, we have a certain definition. Commoners use the word in different ways, whatever they understand. So a commoner, which is the patient's daughter, tells you daddy has diarrhea. He's the fourth week of localized radiotherapy for early stage prostate cancer.
The frequency of diarrhea, how frequent it is there?
So I told you, 4 or 5 times yesterday. Then, so what do you want to differentiate? What do you want to differentiate? The urology unit now teaches it quite well. So for last few years, students don't get confused between the two. Before that, it was universal confusion. Students used to get confused between proctitis and what is the other condition?
Enteritis.
Enteritis. So how would they manifest? What will be the difference? And what happens if you treat proctitis like an enteritis? Namrata, you can answer. So how do you treat acute radiation enteritis and how do you treat the acute radiation proctitis? Manage. No, you had your urology posting, uro-oncology posting.
Yes, sir.
So, and you had your gynae posting?
No, sir.
No, you haven't had gynae posting. So I'm just anyway. You can something even if you haven't had a posting, you can think and answer. Someone is receiving whole pelvic radiotherapy and having diarrhea. Okay. Say 6 or 7 times diarrhea. So what would you advise them? What medicines you will give? See, we are digressing from the main topic, but this is important then that you know this. Okay. So how to differentiate between proctitis and enteritis, radiation proctitis and radiation enteritis. If you know that, you have made that. So that's a clinical diagnosis by asking the question you will make that. You won't do a proctoscopy. You won't do sigmoidoscopy for that. Bolo.
Sir, in case of proctitis, patient will have a tenesmus.
Tenesmus is a very prominent feature of that. And then what else? What do you mean by tenesmus? Does any patient say that I'm having tenesmus? Or it's your medical interpretation patient has tenesmus? Do commoners use this word tenesmus?
No, sir.
So what does the patient will tell you. And the daughter will not will tell you. The patient only can tell you. Hey, because it's a personal experience.
So the patient will have urgency to...
I think we won't spend more time on this, but all of you, you know, you should know how to differentiate between proctitis and enteritis, because the management is, I'll just tell you briefly, I won't go into details now. Patient daughter tells you that has diarrhea, and what is standard thing for diarrhea is anti-motility agent. So someone prescribes Tomotil or loperamide or something, and what will that cause? That will help the patient or harm the patient? At least tell me this.
Sir, it will harm the patient.
Why and how will it harm the patient? So patient with proctitis, with no element. See, you could have both proctitis and enteritis, but this patient has only proctitis and is given a constipating agent. Like, so what? How will it harm the patient?
Sir, the secretions...
secretion. So you are making him on top of it constipated, and just imagine hard stools passing through an inflamed rectum. It will just make it worse. Okay? It's like you have a wound and someone, you know, puts chili on that wound. So it is like that. Just one more thing I want to say, that hemorrhoids, external hemorrhoids are common. So don't ever rule. So you have to rule out the possibility that this patient may have a external hemorrhoid. So whenever they get constipated, external hemorrhoids, they play up again. So keep that in mind, that things which otherwise commonly happen in the population may exist in your patient also. So when you're doing initial evaluation, you should keep note of that. So external hemorrhoids or piles during pregnancy and during any other condition which causes constipation, the external hemorrhoid may start to bleed. So what is the nature of the bleeding along with stools and what time it happens, you keep that in mind. Okay, so all you may have to do is just treat that and not stop radiation. Okay, I think now we'll come to the management. Is Vedant there?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Yeah, so I think if you want to share some pearls with them, how to differentiate between proctitis and enteritis. Some of them do not know. So if you want to, because that is a very common mistake many residents used to make.
I think all those, I think Akshay has not had the posting yet.
Okay.
And they still get that lecture. I think most people now understand that.
Yeah, yeah.
And basically it is that frequent incomplete emptying, frequent 3-4 times in the morning, pain, some blood, some mucus, but the pain and small quantities is what is proctitis classically happens during the treatment. And if you are treating the prostate alone, or then you should never expect enteritis from the radiation, because it's just not going to happen. There's not just enough small bowel. That is something you should think only when the pelvis is treated. And the treatment for this is early recognition, anti-inflammatories and steroids rectally. Enteritis is more like infective. It can be, may or may not be foul smelling, but it's good to rule out infection. Ask what they have eaten, whether they have ordered from Swiggy or something recently more than normal. And there will be mucus, abdominal cramps, pain, bloating, and watery diarrhea multiple times a day. That is enteritis. So that is the difference. And carefully use anti-motility drugs for that.
Yeah, I think that's the key thing.
Yeah.
Thanks, Vedana. Okay, yeah, you all can carry on. Namrata?
Yes, sir. Overall treatment of chronic proctitis, it is divided, it can be divided into non-invasive and invasive methods. Under non-invasive methods, it involves medical therapy, which includes anti-inflammatory agents, sucralfate, then short-chain fatty acids, antioxidants, antimicrobial agents, and hyperbaric oxygen therapy. Under invasive, it can be divided into endoscopic treatment or surgical treatment. In endoscopic treatment, it can be we can do argon plasma coagulation, topical formalin application, or laser NDAG laser treatment. Anti-inflammatory agents can be non-steroidal and steroidal. Under non-steroidal, they usually result in inhibition of prostaglandins, which further decreases the pro-inflammatory factors. The examples are sulfasalazin. Under steroidal, they usually result in stabilization of lysosomes in neutrophils to prevent degranulation. For examples are hydrocortisone, that is enterfoam enema, or prednisolone. Sucralfate is aluminium salt which adheres to the epithelial cells and further stimulates formation of prostacyclins, which results in formation of cytoprotective layer over the cells. Short chain fatty acids such as butyric acid, they provide oxidative fuel to colonic mucosa and therefore stimulate the colonic mucosal proliferation. They also have vasodilator property. Antioxidants such as vitamin A, C, E, they decreases the oxidative stress. Antimicrobial agents, they can be used in chronic radiation proctitis because of their immunomodulatory effect and selective toxicity to microorganisms, which can contribute to pathogenesis of chronic radiation proctitis. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy, it is a mode of medical treatment in which patient is entirely enclosed in a pressure chamber and breathes 100% oxygen at pressure more than one atmospheric absolute. This results in a decrease in tissue hypoxia, which further promotes angiogenesis. It also inhibits bacterial growth and stimulates the release of growth factors, which promotes wound healing. The workup for hyperbaric oxygen therapy includes the routine blood tests such as CBC, LFT, RFT, chest X-ray, ECG, and ENT evaluation. The drawbacks of this treatment are it requires expertise, it is time-consuming and expensive, and it is not readily available. This is the study done by Richard Clark et al. It is a randomized controlled double-blind crossover trial which is done to evaluate the effectiveness of hyperbaric oxygen in patients with refractory chronic radiation proctitis. In this, the patients with chronic refractory radiation proctitis were randomized into two arms, one arm receiving hyperbaric oxygen at 2 atmospheric absolute and second group received air at a 1.1 atmospheric absolute. It was found that the patients receiving hyperbaric oxygen therapy, they have significantly improved healing response as compared to the other group patients. And also they showed enhanced bowel-specific quality of life. In under invasive endoscopic therapy, it is reserved for patients with refractory who are refractory to medical management. There is no level one evidence of benefit in any randomized trials, and the goal of this therapy is mainly to achieve bleeding control of bleeding. It can be the local application. It can be done with the help of local application of formalin. The formalin causes chemical cauterization, therefore results in sclerosis, and therefore seals the fragile microvasculature. It can be applied in the form of 4% rectal instillation or direct topical application of 10% formalin via flexible endoscope or rigid proctoscope or cotton soaked formalin. the timing should be 2 to 3 minutes till blanching of mucosa is seen. Precaution to be taken is perianal skin to be protected because pillage can cause stricture and skin damage. The complications include stricture and fistula formation. Endoscopic coagulation. Coagulation of focal bleeding telangiectic vessel is done with the different types of laser. Argon plasma coagulation is usually a preferred first-line endoscopic therapy. It is a form of electrocautery in which monopolar dithermy is transmitted to target tissue through an ionized gas in a non-contact fashion. Usually 2 to 3 applications are required, which are done 3 weekly. Complications of this therapy include cramps, mucosal discharge, bleeding, fistula and perforation and stricture formation. NDAG laser, that is argon, neodymium, yttrium, aluminium garnet laser can also be used, but the laser is expensive and not widely available. This is this slide here shows the difference between the difference between the two therapies. The depth of perception penetration is more in NDAG laser, and it is less safe, and also it is very it is costly, and complications are more in case of NDAG laser as compared to argon. Surgical options, they are used as last resort. It is reserved for patients with stricture permanent bleeding, bleeding, perforation or fistula that is not responsive to the medical or endoscopic approaches. The surgical options include diverting colostomy or ileostomy, which decreases the symptoms of pain, tenesmus and infection, but no effect on bleeding. Fistula, in case of fistula, local excision of the fistula along with reconstruction with the flaps can be done. Prevention of the radiation proctitis, it can be divided, the strategies can be divided into two main categories. By first is by reducing the dose which is delivered to the adjacent organs. Second is by reducing the radiosensitivity of the organ at risk. Reduction in the dose delivered to the adjacent organs can be done by using modern radiation techniques such as IMRT, IGRT and real-time organ motion management. Use of heavy ions like carbon ions, protons, they have the potential to reduce the normal tissue toxicities, but the long-term outcomes are not clear. Use of physical barriers such as rectal spacers, rectal balloons and vaginal packing can be done to reduce the dose to the...
Okay.
Then second approach is by reducing the radiosensitivity of the organ at risk. It involves medical therapy with amifostine, sucralfate, 5-amino salicylic acid or sulfasalazine. It has only mild effect, and these are not widely used. Newer agents include symbiotics and microbiotics to manipulate the intestinal flora to prevent and treat the chronic radiation.
Instead of saying reducing the sensitivity of normal organ, you say radio protection. That is a more widely used term. Okay.
Rectal spacers, these are implanted as tissue filler into anterior perirectal fat to separate the rectum from the prostate. It results in reduction in maximum dose to the rectum and the total volume of rectum irradiated. It can be done with trust-guided and transperineal approach under local anesthesia. There are different agents used, such as absorbable hydrogel, hyaluronic acid, collagen, and saline filled balloon. The spacer remains in place over the course of RT, and the spacer it biodegrades naturally within 6 months after implantation. Long-term data is not yet available. This slide here shows the spacer between placed between the rectum and the prostate. endorectal balloon. These are also used. They also significantly reduce the rectal volume, which is volume receiving the high dose prostate irradiation. The prostate immobilization is also improved with the endorectal balloon as it pushes the prostate towards the pubic symphysis. This is the endorectal balloon, and here it shows that this is the endorectal balloon which is placed in the rectum, and it is pushing the prostate more anteriorly, and the volume of rectum irradiating is less. And vaginal packing in cervical brachytherapy is also a method to reduce the rectal volume, the volume of rectum irradiated.
Okay. So vaginal packing is not just one of the methods, that is the main method in cervical cancer. Okay. And there are, I don't think you had time, but there are several adaptations in the applicator design. And one of the major changes in the applicator design traditionally were to reduce the rectum and bladder dose. And only recently you have introduced needles and other things, or the ring applicator or other methods to increase the dose to the medial parametrium. But before that, all the major adaptations were to reduce the rectum and bladder dose. Okay, so that is one thing. So any question or any comment? Tanvir, you are also, anything you would like to add to this in your practice, or any points, important learning points for the students, trainees? No. I saw in between Beda from Africa. So if you are there, Beda, then what is kind of cases you all see, and any thing you would like to share? Okay. So, you know, once upon a time, rectal toxicity or radiation proctitis used to be much commoner than radiation cystitis. And if you see at the literature, also older literature, so for every severe radiation cystitis, you would have 3 or 4 cases of severe radiation proctitis. But I think now, the way I think we do brachytherapy, or maybe something to do with that, now radiation cystitis has become as common, or maybe more common than same grade of radiation proctitis. I'm talking of higher grade, grade 3 and 4. So that is one thing. And you should also always tell, see, cancer of the cervix is a disease of the low and middle income countries. You all should have given results of grade 3, 4 or more than grade 2 late rectal toxicities on the management of cervical cancer. From prostate cancer, you may not have so much from India, but for cervical cancer, you should have that from India and from Tata Hospital and from PGI Chandigarh. These are the two institutions which have published their results. So you should know that. And there used to be a time, now people don't. So there used to be the benchmark. What should be, if you are for a certain stage of disease, if you are treating it well, what should be your survival, and what should be your grade 3 and grade 4 rectal and bladder complication rates? And you had to report this. All you have to tell, because it's hard to say whether the local control, yes or no. So OS, overall survival at 5 years, and the grade 3 or 4 rectal toxicity and grade 3 and 4 bladder toxicity at 5 or 10 years. Okay, so these two are mandatory. You have to know this. And that is a benchmark. If any of these things are, you know, if your rectal toxicity is very low, but your survival rates are also poor, that means you're not giving good radiotherapy. And if your survival is good, but you have, say, 10 or 15% grade 3 or 4 rectal toxicity or bladder toxicity, that means you're doing something wrong. You or your team is not being correct. So whenever you all enter into your practice, please have an audit. You may have a series of only 100 cases, but 100 cases is sufficient to tell you that you're going wrong. You means the team. I mean, today no one practices, you know, oncology alone. It is a team that works. So please keep that in mind. Any other, anyone has any suggestion, comments? No. If no, then thank you. And we will continue with the series of toxicities. So I think after bladder and rectum, next we will talk about the skin toxicity, both acute as well as
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. And send it in time. Okay. And you should show a palette of cases. Okay. Bye bye.